Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Saman Siddiqui, Assistant Professor Zoology. Today's topic is sericulture. So, sericulture. Sericulture is an agro-based industry. It involves rearing of silkworm for the production of raw silk is known as sericulture. Silk is the protein secreted by the larva of certain Lepidopteran moth. It is fibrous in nature and widely used for the manufacture of art clothes. Sericulture is the art of rearing silkworms under artificial or domesticated conditions and extraction of the silk fiber from their cocoon. India is the second largest producer of silk with in the globe. Sericulture is a very important domestic industry in many countries. India and China are the world's leading producers of silk. Sericulture also called as silk farming, and it is the process of making silk fibers. It starts by raising silkworms and then processing the fiber they produce. Okay, so the art of rearing silkworm for the production of silk is called as sericulture. It means it's an art of rearing of silkworm. What is silk made up of? Okay, silk is a fiber made up of different proteins. First one is sericin and the second one is fibroin. Approximately 80% of silk fiber is made up of fibroin, which is concentrated at the core, only at the core. This core is surrounded by the layer of sericin, which makes up the remaining 20%. Okay, so 80% fibroin and 20% is sericin. Each type of silk has a different color, as mulberry silk, yellow color or green color, iri silk, creamy white or brick color, tassar silk, copper or brown color, and munga silk is in golden color. Types of silkworms. There are four major types of silkworms. Silks are commercially important, which are obtained from different species of silkworm, which in turn feed on a number of food plants except mulberry. Other varieties of silks are generally termed as non-mulberry silks. So the type of silkworms are, first one is mulberry and rest of the other is non-mulberry, which is tassar, oak, eri, munga. Mulberry silkworm. The bulk of the commercial silk produced in the world comes from this variety, and often silk generally referred to the mulberry silk. Mulberry silk comes from the silkworm Bombax mori, which feed on the leaves of mulberry plants. These silkworms are completely domesticated and reared indoors. In India, the major mulberry silk producing states are Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu and Jammu and Kashmir, which together accounts for 92% of country's total mulberry raw silk production. Okay, look at the picture. This is the picture of mulberry silk form. Next one is tassar silkworm, also called as tusha, and is copperish color coarse silk mainly used for furnishing and interiors. It is less lustrous than mulberry silk but has its own feel and appeal. Tassar silk is generated by the silkworm Antheria mylita, which mainly thrive on the food plants Asan and Arjun. Okay, Asan and Arjun. The rearing are conducted in nature on the tree in the open area. In India, tassar silk is mainly produced in the state of Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Odisha. besides Maharashtra, West Bengal and Andhra Pradesh. Tasar culture is the mainstay for many tribal community in India. Next one, Oak Silk Worm. It is a finer variety of tasar generated by the silkworm in India, which feed on natural food plants of oak, found in abundance of sub-Himalayan belt of India, covering the states of Manipur, Himachal Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Assam, Meghalaya and Jammu and Kashmir. Next, Eri silkworm, also known as ND. Eri is multi-voltine silk spun for open-ended cocoons. Unlike other varieties of silk, Eri silk is the product of domesticated silkworm that feeds mainly on castor leaves. Eri culture is a household activity practiced mainly for protein rich pupa. Thus, silk is used indigenously for preparation of chadars, wraps for own use by these tribals. In India, this culture is practiced mainly in the northeastern states and Assam. It is also found in Bihar, West Bengal and Odisha. Next one, Munga silk. This is in golden yellow color. Silk is propagated of India and pride of Assam state. It is obtained from semi-domesticated multi-voltine silkworm. These silkworms feed on the aromatic leaves of som and solu plants and are reared on trees similar to that of tasar, munga. Munga culture is specific to the state of Assam and integral part of the tradition and culture of the state. The munga silk in high value product is used in products like sarees, chadars, etc. Look at the picture. History. There is no authentic information regarding the origin and use of this silk. No authentic information. The ancient literature gave two views. According to one view, silk industry originated from the first time in India at the foot of the Himalayas, and from there it spread to other countries of the world. Okay. And the second view, which has greater acceptance, says that this industry originated in China about 3000 BC. According to this, a Chinese princess, Siling Chi, was the first to discover the art of reeling an unbroken filament from a cocoon. Okay, history mein kya tha? Koi bhi ek to humare paas mein actually koi information nahi hai. But unhone do view diya tha. That one, first one is silk industry originated from, matlab India mein, foot of Himalaya, and the second one, China. Okay. Next. Life cycle of silkworm. The silkworm Bombyx mori produces the silk of commercial importance. It is the caterpillar of moth whose cocoon is used to make silk. This insect is also called the silkworm moth and the mulberry silkworm. Okay. Moth whose cocoon is used to make silk. This insect is also called the silkworm moth and the mulberry silkworm. Okay, one important point is male and female moth are flightless and lack functional mouth parts. Okay, male and female moths are flightless and lack functional mouth parts. The moth differ in morphological features. The female has a larger abdomen, whereas the male has a much larger pair of antenna. Basic difference. The life cycle of Bombyx mori demonstrate that the most advanced forms of metamorphosis. Okay, most advanced form of metamorphosis. The serial progression of four distinct stages of development complete one generation of species, which is egg, larva, pupa, and imago. So, first, stage 1 is egg. An egg is the first stage of the life cycle of silkworm. The egg is laid by female moth, which is mostly the size of small dots. Completely seems like dot. A female moth lays more than 350 eggs at a time in the springtime. Only in the springtime, no? The eggs hatches due to the warmth in the air. जैसे जैसे थोड़ा थोड़ा बढ़ते जाता है गर्मी, ये हैच हो जाएगा. This procedure happens once in a year. Okay. Next one, larva. A hairy silkworm arises after the eggs crack. In this stage, the larva is in vegetative stage where growth take place. The larva of Bombyx mori, called a silkworm, is host specific to mulberry. During growth, the larva molt 4 times. The period between successive molts is called as instar. So what is instar larva? The period between successive molts is called an instar. Okay. Young silkworm can only feed on tender mulberry leaves. Only feed on tender mulberry leaves. However, during the growth phase, they can eat together mulberry leaves as well. The larval stage lasts for about 27 days and the silkworm goes through 5 growth stages called instar during this time. During the first molting, the silkworm shed all its hair and gain a smooth skin. Next one, pupa. As the silkworm prepares to pupate, it spins a protective cocoon. The silk cocoon serves as protection for the pupa. Cocoon are shades of white, cream, and yellow, depending on the silkworm genetics. After a final molt inside the cocoon, the larva develop into brown chitin covered structure called pupa. Okay. After final molt, larva develops into chitin covered structure. It means which is called pupa. Metamorphic changes of the pupa result in the emerging of moth. Now, after pupa, there is emerging of moth. Cocoon. Cocoon is the stage in which the larva spins silk thread around it. Okay, around it to protect itself from its predator. Obviously, to protect itself from predator. The larva trap itself inside the cocoon in order to pupate. The color of the cocoon varies depending upon what the silkworm eat. Okay. Cocoon. The color of cocoon varies depending upon what the silkworm eats. It can range from white to golden yellow. The second molting occurs inside the cocoon when the larva turns into a brown pupa. It takes about 2 to 3 for the pupa to metamorphose into an adult moth. Okay. It takes about 2 to 3 weeks. Next, imago. The adult stage completes the life cycle of Bombyx mori. It is the reproductive stage where adult male and female lays egg. Moths are flightless and lack functional mouth part, so are unable to consume the food or nutrition. They are actually unable to consume the food and unable to consume the nutrition for themselves. Once the adult moth comes out of its cocoon, its only purpose is to find a member of the opposite sex and mate. Males are larger than female and more active. They flap their wings rapidly to attract the female. Within 24 hours of mating, the male moth dies. While the female lays abundant number of eggs, after which it dies as well, thereon a new silkworm life cycle begins. rearing of silkworm. So, any building or thatch which is well ventilated may be used for rearing the worms, but mud wall thatched houses are the best as they are cool in summer and warm in winter season. During summer season, water may be sprinkled inside the thatch to lower the high temperature. Sprinkling of water. For proper growth and development of silkworm, the temperature inside the house should be maintained more or less between 70 degree to 75 degree Fahrenheit with similar percentage of humidity. Okay. Rearing of silkworm. Various practices required for rearing of silkworm. Feeding tray, machan, nets, pinning tray. So first one is feeding tray. Freshly hatched worms are kept in flat trays along with small pieces of mulberry leaves for feeding. These trays are made up of bamboo mattings, okay, mattings with their edges turned up. Then next one is machan. Machan are needed to accommodate large number of tray in a limited space. Machan are easily and best made by fixing two pairs of bamboo or wooden poles in the ground. Okay. Nest and spinning tray. Large amount of excreta, dirty product and remains of leaves may fall on the tray from the holes of the upper tray. Okay. If worms are not protected from these byproducts, they may get diseased. To prevent this, tray are covered with the nets. Now spinning tray. Before cocoon formation, mature worms are transferred to special type of tray known as spinning tray. Here they spin the cocoon without any disturbance. Here they spin the cocoon without any disturbance. Precautions. Precautions should be taken during the rearing of mulberry silkworm. The first one is, the worm should never be kept overcrowded in a tray. Dried or dusty wet leaves should never be fed to the worms. No doubt free ventilation is must, but wind should not be allowed directly over the worms. There should be equal distribution of leaves among the worms. Worms which are under process of molting should not be disturbed, otherwise they may die or molting may be delayed. There should be no dust at the floor of the house. Smoking should be strictly prohibited in the rearing room. If it is very hot, drinking water may be sprinkled over the feeding tray. All the pictures of this video is taken from google.com for reference only. Thank you.